Mr. True, in this math lesson, we're going to be taking a look at an induction proof that deals with divisibility. Now, a long time ago, actually, I made a video, I'm going to post a link to it in the description, where we were proving a partial sum formula when we first got introduced to sequences and series. And indeed, that's where you start to look at induction proofs for the first time. You know, if you add so many numbers, you know, instead of adding so many numbers like 10 or 100 or 10,000 numbers, is there some kind of partial sum formula that will work to streamline or shortcut that process? And at the time, I only had to deal with those types of induction proofs, but now we're going to take a look at some divisibility. And we're going to prove by mathematical induction that 9 to the n power minus 1 is a multiple of 8 for all n, such that n is a set of the positive integers. This sort of double Z notation is a symbol for positive integers that the current textbook I'm using, or teaching from, uses. Chalk down! Okay. Well, does this even, I mean, how can we prove this? You know, will it work if n is equal to 1? Well, we have 9 to the first power minus 1 is equal to 8, and 8 is certainly a multiple of 8. We have n is equal to 2. And I'm not going to do like a 1.2 or 1.3 because we have n as a set of the positive integers. So what if n is equal to 2? Well, we have 9 squared is 81, and 81 minus 1 is equal to 80. Well, that's 8 times 10, so that's a multiple of 8. And then if we have n is equal to 3, we have 9 cubed minus 1. Well, now 9 cubed is 729. And 729 minus 1 is equal to 728. And if you divide 728 by 8, you get an answer of 91. Again, another integer. So these three values, when n is, you know, that we get from letting n equal 1, 2, and 3, are clearly multiples of 8. So I just proved it, right? No. I just did three examples, you know, but what happens when n is equal to 4, and then 10, and then 10,000, and so on and so on? We can just show as many examples as we would like, and then me, as a, you know, math teacher, can just simply say, hey, you showed it worked a bunch of times, what about the next n? Well, that's the idea of what an induction proof does for us. We're going to prove we're going to start with some P of n statement, which we want to prove true for all values of n, where again, n is within that element of positive integers. And we're going to then, so I'm going to start with something like let P of n equal our statement, and then go somewhere. We're going to see that in a second. We're then going to prove that P of 1 is true. And your starting value, we say that n is this within this set of positive integers, but our first initial value doesn't really necessarily have to be 1. It might be such that we have some kind of statement like this, but it starts where n is equal to 3 and then goes on from there, 3, 4, 5, 6, and so on and so on. So our initial value is not always equal to 1, but it is usually. We're then going to assume that P of k is true, where k is a particular value of n is greater than or equal to 1, and kind of think of this as, yes, we're going to try and prove that P of n is true. We're going to let P of n represent some kind of statement involving 9 to the n power minus 1 and being some kind of multiple of 8. And we're going to assume P of k is true. And effectively, k is kind of acting as the same variable as n, but we're kind of differentiating our work within the proof from the actual statement which we are trying to prove true. You don't want to make it seem like in your proof that you're already assuming what you're trying to prove true is. You don't want to make that assumption that it's true before you even, you know, start your proof. That's what we're going to try and justify as we finish this. And then we're going to use the assumption that if P of k is true to then show that P of k plus 1 is also true. And what does this notation mean here of P of k and P of k plus 1? Basically here, you know, let's make sure that some kind of statement works at least once. And then maybe, not that k has to be equal to 2, it can be any particular value of n. But if we just say for a second, you know, think about k possibly equaling 2, then if we assume some that this statement is true for some k, then can we use that assumption? Hey, I mean, it worked when n was equal to 1. Let's use that assumption to see if it works when n is equal to 2 or if k is equal to 2. Well, can we use some kind of statement with k involving some type of number to then show that it's true for the next positive integer? And if we can get those dominoes to start falling, like I said, hey, it worked for 1, well, then it might work for 2, then it might work for 3, then it might work for 4. We're not going to do an infinite number of examples. We're going to let that 2 lead to 3, lead to 4, lead to 5 with this general statement of k is any particular value. Assume that this statement is working for that particular value and let it knock down the next domino of k plus 1, or if it works for 2, it works for 3, then it works for 4, and so on and so on. The induction proof allows those dominoes to fall without you having to, you know, do an infinite number of sort of concrete numerical examples like we have here. So that's what we're going to do. We're going to get this out of the way and do our induction proof. We're going to let, we're going to get a full piece of chalk is what we're going to do. We're going to let P of N represent or be equal to nine to the n power minus 1. We're going to let that equal 8 times A, where N again is within that set of positive integers, and so is A. Okay, we're again taking that value of 9, raising it to some positive integer, and getting an answer which is a multiple of 8. And that's only it's only possible to have some kind of positive multiple of A if we're only letting N be a positive integer. And then we're going to show or consider n equals 1 and prove that P of 1 is true. So for step 1, P of 1, consider that. Well, we have 9 to the first power minus 1 on the left-hand side, let's remember that, is equal to 9 minus 1, which is 8. And on the right-hand side, you know, we basically have, you know, that we have an 8. Now, I'm not going to write 8a because saying that 8 is equal to 8a is saying that 8 is equal to 8 times any positive integer. That doesn't make any sense. But clearly, we know and can see that 8 is a multiple of 8. The left and right-hand sides can be equal, as, of course, I guess, as long as a is equal to 1. So we've proven that P of 1 is true. So therefore, P of 1 is true. So we've shown, like, really I just already did in the yellow chalk, that this statement works when n is equal to 1. So instead of letting then try in 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and forever, we're just going to say we're going to assume P of k is true. So, i.e., we have 9 to the k power minus 1 is equal to 8a, where k is a set of positive integers. All right. Assuming that this is true, can that allow us to prove this? So with induction proofs, you come up with, you know, you're given a statement, and just to match the notation of my book, I'm saying let P of n represent that statement. We're going to show that it works for when n equals 1 or whatever our initial value is. if it works, if we can show that that's actually true, then maybe it works for every positive integer. So we're going to assume that P of K is true, i.e., like I'm not, it's kind of just like a statement or an example of what I'm representing here. I'm not saying that it's true. It's not like, you know, therefore we have this. We have 9 to the k power minus 1 is equal to 8a, and that a representing positive integers, therefore representing an integer multiple, positive integer multiple of a, like you saw, or 8, like you saw in our three sort of arithmetic examples. Now, if we want to prove, therefore, that the statement is still going to be true for the next k, the next positive integer, then I'm just going to replace anywhere that I have a variable of k, replace it with k plus 1, but my b here, my 8 times b, I can't use the same positive integer variable because, well, if I'm taking 9 and I'm raising it to the next consecutive positive integer power, of course I'm not going to get the same multiple of 8, I'm going to get another multiple of 8. So I need to redefine this as, or within my proof, that still b is within that set of all positive integers. Now that's what I want to prove. This isn't the proof. It's basically like my proof is done if I, you know, if I can get some kind of statement where I can prove that these two sides match. Like this is the end of my proof. This is what I want it to look like when I'm done. So my proof starts here. My proof starts where I take one of the two sides of the statement. It's usually going to be the left-hand side, but it doesn't need to be. You kind of just start with the side of the statement that you think will be the easiest to start from. Probably that's going to include some kind of simplification process until you get it to match the other side. So we're going to start here with our proof on the left-hand side, which is 9 to the k plus 1 power minus 1. Now that is going to be equal to our left-hand side, that is going to be equal to 9, actually let me write this over here, 9 to the k times 9 minus 1 power. I'm going to go ahead and separate the, yeah, like that. I'm going to go ahead and separate this base and write the 9 to the k plus 1 power as 9 to the k times 9 to the first, because when you multiply like bases, you add the exponents. Now, what would even make me want to write this statement? What would make me think, hey, I want to take that 9 to the k plus 1 and write it as 9 to the k times 9 to the first? How do I make this really become 9b? Well, to, you know, we're going to try and prove, remember, that p of the k plus 1 is true, assuming this fact that 9 to the k minus 1 is equal to 8a. Like we're assuming, we don't really know that this is true, but we're assuming this is true. And if it's true, we can put this information, somehow get information from our assumed statement into our proof. And if we can get the two sides to match, if I can somehow get an 8b to come out of this work by using this assumed information, then the dominoes are starting to fall, and we have, you know, shown with the mathematical induction that, you know, n of any, or 9 to the any positive integer power minus 1 is that multiple of 8, or, you know, gives you an answer that's divisible by 8. So I'm just simply looking here and trying to figure out how am I going to get some information from this statement into my proof, and, well, I have a 9 to the k power. So I wouldn't necessarily want a 9 to the k plus 1 power. I need that 9 to the k power to show up. Now from here, you know, proofs, just like you were in pre-calculus with your trig proofs, you can go down multiple paths. Now, I can manipulate this to a point where I finally see a 9 to the k minus 1 show up, or since I already have a 9 to the k power in this next step of my proof, I can rewrite this assumption statement and say, well, if I'm assuming this to be true, well then basically I have 9 to the k is equal to 8a minus or plus 1. Now I'm just taking this and I'm adding both sides by 1. Now I'm not trying to prove this statement. I've assumed it to be true. When you work with a proof, now I started with just one side of the proof. I'm not really setting up as an equation. It's like this left-hand side is now equal to, I've rewritten that left-hand side. But in a proof, you can't move terms and factors from the left to the right-hand side of an equation within the middle of a proof. But I'm not trying to prove this is true. I'm assuming it already is true. So we have 9 to the k is equal to 8a minus or 8a plus 1. Okay, so we have this is equal to 9 to the k power is coming out, and in its place, I'm going to plug in 8a plus 1 times 9 minus 1. Okay, now let's clean this up a little bit. We're going to distribute the 9 through these parentheses. You get 72a plus 9 minus 1. Simplifying this some more, we have 72a plus 8 in the phone. Excuse me for that. And now here, it seems like we're getting farther and farther away from this goal of writing 8b, but actually 72 and 8 are both divisible by 8, so we can factor an 8 out, and we have 9a plus 1. We have 8 times something. If we can justify that this something being multiplied to 8 is an integer, well, that's what b is. It's another positive integer, just simply not the same positive integer as a, but that still means it's a multiple. Well, if a is a set within that set of positive integers, then, you know, a positive integer multiplied by a positive integer plus 1 is going to give you another positive integer. So therefore, we have the ability of replacing 9a plus 1 with just the letter b. And so we've shown that, you know, 9n minus 1, where n is a positive integer, is a multiple of 8. We showed that it worked when n is equal to 1. So instead of doing n is equal to 2 and is n equal to 3, 4, 5, and so on, we're going, okay, maybe this statement just works. And based on that assumption, when we go to the next integer, or k plus 1 integer, and say, well, then this has to be equal to another positive integer multiple of 8, and using that assumed fact within our proof, we got that AB pattern. So, let's see. Since P of 1 was true, and P of K plus 1 was proven true, assuming P of K was true, then by the principle. Nope, I knew I was going to misspell that. That's why I teach math. Principle of mathematical induction, P of N is true. And that is how you do an induction proof for divisibility. I'm Mr. True. Bam! Go do your homework.